Homework Hotline is supported in part by New York State United Teachers, working with parents and the community for our children's future. NYSET, a union of professionals, and by viewers like you.
When you have got a question and you just can't figure it out, just give us a shout and call the Homework Hotline. The Homework Hotline. The Homework Hotline. The Homework Hotline.
And welcome to Homework Hotline. I'm Joe Zuniga.
Hi, and I'm Ed Hathaway. Homework Hotline is the place where you can get help with your homework on the phone, online, or on TV.
And now here's how it works. There's teachers from Dial Tier 2 standing by right now to take your call and help you with your homework.
Now, if you'd like help with your homework, call Dial Teacher Free at 1-888-986-2345.
Now, remember, you can also send us your questions on our website. Just go to homeworkhotline.org, click on the Yak Back button, and send in your questions.
All right, great. Now, before we get to our science challenge, we'd like to remind viewers that a little later in the show, Tim Cawley from the Rochester Museum and Science Center will be here with an explosive experiment. But we do have a science challenge. Let's get to it.
I know.
Yeah, Mr. Z.
I don't know. I hope the explosive experiment.
Yeah,
I'm not
going
to be nothing.
I'm too close. Yeah. Way too close to you.
Well, I've got a balance in front of us.
Gotcha.
All right. And balances are used to measure mass,
okay,
which is similar to, but not the same as weight.
Same as weight, yeah.
Right.
You've explained that to
okay.
me 10 times.
You measure your weight on a scale, you measure mass on a balance.
Gotcha.
All right.
Okay.
And because your mass doesn't change. You know, I guess the example I gave out earlier was that, you know, if you're a slim, trim 180 here on Earth, right?
Uh-huh.
Now, if you went up into the International Space Station, you would weigh nothing. You'd be weightless, right?
Right.
But there's still the same amount
still
of you.
Still amount of weight, right.
And so that's your mass.
What you used was a ton of feathers versus
oh, yeah.
a ton of feathers bricks.
Versus a ton of bricks.
Still a ton.
Yeah. All right. So here's what I'm going to do. I've got this already set. And
right.
I've got this metal cube here. I've actually got two metal cubes.
Yeah,
notice they're different sizes.
One's larger than the other. Yeah.
So I'm going to put this one on our balance first, and we'll see that it's already set. I think it was about 119, or it was about 19. I can't remember 19 point something grams.
Grams.
Right.
Yeah, that's
but
grams.
I guess what we're looking at more than what it actually is then I've got the smaller cube.
That it
I'm
balanced.
Put that on. I'm going to put that
yeah,
on there.
I see, and it balances in the same way.
Yeah. So these two have the same mass. Now, they're clearly not the same size.
Yeah.
Notice they're very different in size.
They are different.
And
mm-hmm.
are different metals, too, we can see. All right. But that's going to be our question. The question is, what's the property that allows these two metal cubes to have the same mass?
All right. That is a great question, Mr. Z.
Hey.
Hopefully we get a lot of callers on that. Again, our science challenge for tonight is, what property allows the smaller cube to have the same mass as the larger cube? Now, if you think you could solve this science challenge, give our hotline a call at 1-866-264-5904, or you could just answer on our website, homeworkhotline.org. Answer correctly, and you could have a chance to answer it at the end of the show.
But remember, every correct response will be at our Homework Hotline Hall of Fame, and if you earn enough points, you could win one of those tablets at the end of the season.
All right.
Okay, and we're calling Homework Hotline so we can do some homework.
Let's do some homework.
Okay.
Hello.
Hello.
Is this AJ?
Hello.
Hi, AJ.
Hey.
How are you?
Good.
Good? All right, Dan. What kind of question do you have for us, AJ?
I have a geometry question.
All right, get away from all this science stuff for a little while.
do a little
some
math.
Math.
All
yeah.
right.
All right. A little geometry. It's been a while since I've done a geometry problem. AJ, what have you got for us?
I have to write a two-column proof, and it shows how these two lines are parallel. And I need to figure out how angle 2 and angle 6 are congruent.
Okay. So let's do our parallel lines before we set up our proof. Do the parallel lines, are they labeled like A and B or X and Y or something?
They're labeled L and M.
L and M. Okay. What else do you see in this picture with these parallel lines?
I see a transversal line intersecting it.
Okay, that's a great thing. Let's talk about a transversal line. AJ, what does that mean? What is a transversal line?
A line that intersects the line, the parallel line.
All right, so that means this line here, as a matter of fact, we should show everything being lines that could go on indefinitely. So let's do that. They're not line segments, they're lines. All right, so we got a transversal. Sometimes, AJ, the transversal is also labeled. Is it labeled on your picture, the transversal? Does it have?
No.
Okay, we'll worry about it then. Okay, I'm guessing that some of these angles, especially 2 and 6, they're on this picture somewhere. So help me out. In the upper left, has that one got a number?
Yeah, it's a 1.
1, and I assume 2 is just to the right of it, huh?
Yeah.
Okay, and where is 6?
6 is like, not all the way at the bottom, but like
all right.
The second to the bottom on the right.
Right here, I'm guessing, because when you read the original question, you said, how are these two angles congruent? And you mentioned angle 2 and angle 6, didn't you? Okay,
yeah.
Let's get a different color up there so we can see. Let's do red. We want to do this guy and this guy. We want to prove that they are congruent using a two-column proof, right?
Yeah.
Okay, now help me out, AJ. I'm going to set up my two columns.
Okay.
All right, how are your columns headed? When I used to teach this stuff, we used to say statements and reason. How does your classroom do it?
What you just said.
Okay, all right, so we'll do statement here. What's the mathematical thing? And then the reason for it. Now, usually we do the given first. What is given to us in this problem, AJ?
That line L and line M are parallel.
Okay, all right. I'm just gonna show it using this double line going up and down. That's our math symbol for parallel, isn't it, AJ? So
yes.
L is parallel to M, and the reason is, well, they gave us that. That's a given, okay? All right, so that's given. Now, the next step, really, this is a two-step proof, isn't it? Okay? We could say that the transversal is given. Could throw that in there too as well. I'm not going to, but we could, I guess. But now, once we know these are parallel, we can say that angle 2, I'm going to use the congruent symbol, is congruent to angle 6, but we got to give a reason. You know a reason for that, AJ? What is it?
I learned about corresponding angles.
There you go. It's the definition of corresponding angles. I'm running out of room here, but I'll put it in. Definition of corresponding angles is the reason. All right, now let's go over all these different kinds of angles. All right, AJ? You're a smart guy. Once you have these parallel lines cut by a transversal, if the angle on each line is in the same relative position, does that make sense? Isn't 2 and 6, aren't they in the same relative position to the right of the transversal above the parallel line? Then they're going to be equal, okay? Will angle 1 be equal to angle 2 or angle 6?
No.
No, they aren't. We could figure out if we had numbers, we know that a straight line makes 180. If we wanted to figure out what angle 1 was, we would say, well, it's 180, take away whatever angle 2 is. You know, that would give us that, okay? Now, there's other things that are equal by all of this, AJ. For example, let me put up another number here. Let's say 3 here, okay? What's the relationship, AJ? Do you know the relationship between angle 2 and angle 3?
They're supplementary?
Well, they're going to be equal. But do you know the reason why? No, they won't be supplementary. I'm going to put their thing there, too. Okay, there's something called, I think you learned this, called vertical angles.
Yeah,
when they're like kind of across from each other diagonally, that means if we had an angle here, I'll say 7, that would also be equal to all these guys. Okay?
I think you put 3 in the wrong place.
I put what in the wrong place?
Angle 3. I think it should be on the right.
Oh, you had an angle. Oh, I'm sorry. I didn't know you actually had a number for that. I just made that up, AJ. That's my fault. Okay? I could get rid of that and put it back in properly. You had angle 3 down here?
Yeah.
vertical to one, okay. Then angle one and angle three would be equal. I'll put a four here, I guess. Get the red back, and that would be equal. Okay. I was just kind of making up. I didn't realize you had it labeled there. But now you're learning something about vertical angles and corresponding angles. Transversals, yep, and parallel lines. That was a great question, AJ. Thanks.
Need help with your homework? Call Dial a Teacher for free at 1-888-986-2345. And don't forget, Dial a Teacher is open Monday through Thursday from 3:30 to 7 p.m.
Now, we'll get back to the questions in just a moment, but now we'd like to welcome from the Rochester Museum and Science Center, welcome Tim to the show.
Hey, guys.
Hi,
good to see you again.
Good.
Right. Hey, well, today, as you can tell, we've got a little bit of a Halloween flair to it.
I see that.
We've got our little pumpkin. We can take the goggles off him because we're going to be using him later.
Because we may need those.
That's right, just in case. But what we're going to be working with is something called calcium carbide.
Okay. All right, cool.
Now, that was pretty much so invented around 1892. And the cool part about it, it's a man-made compound, but what's really neat about it is it's Frederick Walthar. It came up with when you put water into it, it actually starts to break down. It takes some of the water, some of the hydrogen molecules, and it turns around and it makes acetylene.
Cool. I was asked about acetylene earlier.
And
so acetylene, let's use acetylene torches. You know, you see where they're cutting metal with.
So a little bit of explosion, a little bit of fire.
A little bit of explosion, but we'll show you how it's
done.
I have
another question, Tim. Man-made, so they take other chemicals and then combine them, right? Literally like that, and
As a matter of fact, they make this own. They took lime and coke and put it together. Not the mixers, but the actual coke being as coal that's been broken down a little bit, and then they take the lime. And the reason why they put them together, they use what's known as electric arc furnace or oven, and it turns around and it actually puts the electricity into
luck.
No, they actually did it on purpose. Finding this was a little bit of luck. Well, there's serendipity in just about everything you do. So right now what we'll do is we'll take a look and see how it might work. I'm going to put my goggles on.
All right.
I'm going to do the same thing.
Now, as you may remember, coke from you probably learned about steel making. You know, with Carnegie, all the steels. That's
I have no idea, but I think we're going to find out right now.
Okay.
Now, what we'll do? We've got a lot in there.
That's considered a lot, huh?
Well, yeah.
Okay.
I won't lie to you, and we'll light up a little bit. Now, as you watch this, you'll be able to, I'll put a little bit forward so you get a good view on it. You'll be able to see it start to foam up.
Wow, that's cool.
And
whoa! Thank goodness for the goggles.
You can see it actually, that's the acetylene gas, which still is
still a little bit there.
Yeah.
But we'll put it out. And that, what it does right there, is it actually starts to release the acetylene. And actually, there's a lot of countries that still use this method to get acetylene. Now, you can partially burn methane and drive it a little bit easier.
Oh, I didn't know that.
But it works pretty well. Mm-hmm. And it's pretty neat. And actually, what we're going to do for when we talk about our pumpkin, because, big thing that they used it for, calcium carbide. I almost forgot to tell you, is they use it for carbide lamps. In the mines.
Okay.
What they would do is really pretty cool. They have, you know, the old doctor's mirrors that you used to see?
Sure.
Kind of concave mirrors.
That.
We have this little concave mirror with a port for the gas to come out. And what they do is they have a chunk of this calcium carbide behind that. You're wearing it on your head. Behind it, and there's a little water source on top, and it just drips chips, chips really slowly, and they light that, and it lights the flame.
So they could simply see what they were doing down there.
Right. And it worked really well, unless you were in a coal mine. And you got to be careful because coal mine's a lot of methane.
Yeah. Uh-huh.
And turn around, sometimes that would explode. But in many other, like tin or copper or silver mines, they would use it quite a bit. And actually,
safer in those mines.
Much safer because the methane isn't as prevalent.
Right.
And turn around, a lot of cave explorers use this because of the great light it used to give. Uh-huh. Now, of course, we use LEDs, so it's still
much safer and easier.
Much safer and easier.
Yeah.
But as we're going to work about, let's talk about Mr. Jack here, Jack-o'-lantern. We've got Jack. I've got him set up. What we're going to do is we're going to take some of the calcium carbide. We're going to put it inside here. We're going to pour a little water in. Then we'll cover him up.
I'm worried about Jack here.
Oh, Jack will be fine.
All right.
You, on the other hand, might not be so lucky.
So I might be in trouble.
And then we'll back off.
We're
going to use
be assured.
Our earmuffs. Because anytime you're going to hear a loud noise, or a chance to hear a loud noise, always remember to protect your ears. And this, it's going to make a little loud noise, probably, hopefully, if it works out well.
Okay.
If it doesn't do it right off the first time, trust me, it'll find its way there.
It's always interesting when you do something on live television.
So I'm nervous to teach a math. You didn't play with all those toys.
It's worked every time I've tried it.
Every time. Okay.
Both, yes.
Well, if it doesn't work, we can blame Ed.
That's right.
Wouldn't be the first time.
Won't be the last. That's right. But I'm right there with you.
All right, Tim. We're ready.
Put this inside here. Right. And why don't we put our goggles on? You've got them on already. And our ear protection.
All right. Step away.
Always a good idea. I want to see where I've got my little bit of water. And I got my light stick.
Can you see it? Do you want me to hold anything for you, Tim?
What's that?
Do you want me to hold anything for you? Are you all set?
Oh, no, I think I've got it right now. So it's.
Why are you putting on the glove?
They always say to do that. And we got these really cool big gloves, so we'll do it.
All right. I thought maybe there was more reason to it than that.
Well, he's going
to
hold the top on the pumpkin.
Top down, okay. All right.
There we go.
There we are.
And Scully, good luck. Oh, look at
that. How do you do?
That's great. Hey. Look at your carvings.
Pretty good. I think you lost one of his teeth.
1, 2, 3 main.
And you know what? The best part is, I didn't have anything to do with the carving. Uh-huh. All right, so I did. It's really a pretty, it's a really pretty cool demo.
Yeah, that is a very cool demo,
It's a little loud. Takes a second for it to go off. And you notice that smell, a lot of people say it smells a little bit like garlic. Kind of a little nasty, but it's still working. We could light it again, but we've lost our little
part. Yeah, not as much sighting.
No, that's why it's kind of a one-trick pony.
Hey,
it works out pretty well. But it's very cool, and it's just the idea that it's what countries and industry used to use back in the day. Mm-hmm. And you figure 1892 they came up with this, so really turn of the century, and it's great stuff. The acetylene, we still use a lot of acetylene today for our torches, and actually the byproduct of it for metallurgy, so it's pretty neat.
For our chemistry students, maybe we'll talk a little bit about what acetylene is, because acetylene is the common name, right? But what you have is two carbons that are triple bonded with hydrogen on either end, and you know they're learning their families, and that's the first in the ethyne family with a triple bonded carbon, so it's cool. Yeah.
It's starting to make a little more sense to me. When you science teachers talk, sometimes it's Greek to me.
Well, a lot of the time, things have a common name and they have the chemical name, but, acetylene is something that they don't, learn as acetylene, but they do learn about.
Okay, so when you guys do this with your students, you're telling them, okay, now be careful with this.
Make sure you wear
goggles all the time, wear the headgear.
Safety's first.
It's a given, especially this time of year. It's really important that kids understand that you don't play with fire, you don't play with electricity. Uh-huh. A lot of times, because it's Halloween, people want to see really cool stuff. Mm-hmm. You still got to be careful because there's things out there. We've been doing it for a long time, and everything here is really pretty safe. Uh-huh. And you turn around, and you've practiced it, and with those guys out there, somebody got hit with a little pumpkin, but
but I think they're like,
I'm glad you don't have to claim.
But it works out pretty well. But it's always The best part is it's science, and science is just very cool, and kids really got to understand that math and science is where it's going to be.
Nothing happens without science.
Nothing at all.
I can't tell you how many times Mr. Z has told me that.
Exactly. 100% right. 100% right.
I want to thank you for coming on.
No, I had a great time, guys. You guys, always a great time.
We'll see you again soon.
Yeah. Hope so.
All right. Now, if you'd like to know more about the Rochester Museum Science Center, where Tim hears from, head to our website, homeworkhotline.org, and stay right there now. We'll be back in just a second.
Spain has a rich culture that is known for its love of life, especially spending time with friends and family. Soccer, religious festivals, regional dances, and music are also an important part of life for the people of Spain. Spain is located in Europe and shares the Iberian Peninsula with Portugal. Droughts are very common in Spain, even though rivers flow from coast to coast, creating good farmland. The interior of Spain can get very hot in the summer and cold and dry in the winter. Spain is also an ideal location for birds migrating from Europe and Africa. They use Spain as a resting spot before they continue on with their journey. Spain is also home to many mammals like the lynx, wildcat, wild boar, and wild goat. Spain attracts the second largest amount of tourists each year behind France. The money brought in from tourism really helps this country's economy. It has the eighth largest in the world.
I'm going to do a lesson at the board here on a basic multiplication decimals. Yeah,
great.
Math, now that we've done enough science.
Never enough science.
Over at Dial the Teacher and even here at the studio, a lot of our math questions come back down to multiplying with decimals, particularly with money. So I'm going to do a math problem. I got the side pin so I can actually do some math with it. And I'm going to multiply 2.0 times 0.5. Now, both of these values have decimal points in them. Okay, we all know that if you take the number 2 and cut it in half, well, your answer is going to be 1, right? Okay, but we're going to go through the basic steps how you do multiplication of decimals so that when you do, you can just follow along here. Well, the first step says to multiply is normal, so I'll do that. 5 times 0 is 0, 5 times 2 is 10. Okay, so multiply is normal. Then it says count the number of digits to the right of the decimal in both values. All right, well, I've got two values that I multiplied. I got one digit here, two digits. Let me just make note of it. I had two digits that were to the right of the decimal. All right, and the final step says begin to the far right of the number, place the decimal moving left as many values as calculated step 2. So I'm going to start far right. It said to move 2 spots, 1, 2. I get 1.00. Of course, these zeros are insignificant, but the answer is 1. Just like we stated that if you took 2 and cut it in half, you would get a value of 1. But these three steps, multiply, count the decimal, and move the decimal, can work for any and much larger multiplication of decimal problems. Thanks.
All right, now we have a winner tonight's science challenge. Hello.
Hi.
Hi, who's this?
Matthew.
Hi, Matthew.
Matthew, what grade are you in?
10.
And where do you go to school?
Oh, MacArthur High School in Levittown.
Okay, that's fine. Matthew, what is the property that allows these both to have the same mass? Or excuse me, same
density.
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 Very good. So even though the aluminum block is much larger, the other one's brass, right? Okay.
Yes.
They don't have the same density. So which one has the greater density?
Mass.
Okay, density is mass divided by volume, right?
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Yep. And so the brass being smaller, having the smaller volume, okay, has the larger density so that the mass could be equal, right?
Okay.
Very cool. Now, what have you been doing in school with density?
Well, I'm in honors chemistry.
Okay.
Impressive.
Well, I can't say about the density because I don't think we learned that yet.
Okay, but you know, if you took earth science, you probably did a lot with density in earth science. It's the difference in the density of warm air and cold air that causes all our weather systems.
Okay, but you go from density, you can also calculate mass and volume then.
Right.
Right, with using the same formula.
Right.
Maybe you've done that, Matt? Have you done that simple formula?
Yes, I did.
Yeah, okay. So you can move from one aspect to another quite readily with that simple formula.
Yep.
You know?
And you know, you probably did also in earth science that why do objects float? Either, now we're not talking buoyancy, but less dense object will float on the more dense object. Mm-hmm. All right, maybe we'll have to do some demos with that coming
up. All right, that's up to you, Mr. Z.
Thank you, Edward. Thank you, Joseph.
Thank you. Bye-bye.
Thanks, Matthew. You did a nice job. All right.
Okay.
All right. Well, congratulations.
Yeah. Well, we're losing.
Now, don't forget, every correct response will go into our Homework Hotline Hall of Fame, earn up points, and you could win a tablet at the end of the season.
All right. Now, that's all the time we have tonight. We are going to say goodbye, but remember, Dial Teacher is available with free homework help on the phone until 7 tonight.
Now, tune in on Monday for our Halloween Spooktacular.
Good night.
Good night.
Homework Hotline is supported in part by New York State United Teachers, working with parents and the community for our children's future. NYSET, a union of professionals, and by viewers like you.